roll call. Madam Clerk.
Chairman Young.
I am here.
Director Ferguson.
Do you want me to take them off?
Director Martinez. Director Spitzer.
Here.
Director Puckett.
Here.
Director Sacks.
Yes, I'm here. Over here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Director Crane.
Sorry. Did that give us a forum, or are we short still? Oh, there's an opting idea.
That makes it eight.
Okay, so we will call this as a committee of the whole. We are not taking action today anyway, and I'm sure we'll have a couple of the directors working their way in. Once again, welcome. We are glad that you are here. I will forewarn all, I woke up with an unusual headache, so if I invited anybody today, just throw a pencil at me or something like that, and I'll try to soften up. But I also understand that some of us must leave early. If that's the case, what we'd ask that you do is look at the speaker, slam your hands against the table, and storm out if you said something offensive. Feel free, if you need to leave, by all means, you're welcome to do so. For those who don't know, there are restrooms as you leave right off to the left-hand side, so feel free to come and go as desired. We are filming, as is our custom, so keep that in mind. And other than that, we are going to begin with board business.
Back of my head.
Board members, I'm going to ask this, if I may please. There is a presentation that we are going to have, and if you would hold your questions and comments till the end of the presentation, and Sharon has told us it'll probably take 50 minutes, maybe an hour, to go through the extensive material she has. So, just button it up, write your questions down, and that'll give her a chance to go through all the material. What we have found sometimes is that she might answer your question in the process of the material, and it might actually fit better with the order that she has. So if you will do that, that's how we will begin the board business. From that point, we are going to go to, ladies and gentlemen, we'll go to board questions and board comments that Sharon will be able to answer for us, and then we'll go to public comments after that. Typically, we have a three-minute limit, but we are trying to have this be more engaging. So if your question is longer than 3 minutes, by all means, take as much time as you need. If your question's more of a comment, then maybe I'll close you a little closer to that. But we want to get all the questions answered at that point. So with that, Mr. Cheney, would you please introduce our speaker?
Chair Young, members of the board, my name is Mike Chesney. I'm Chief Strategy Officer here at PCA. Back in April of 2015, we launched a larger effort to assess opportunities for mobility improvements in South Orange County. The Foothill Eastern Transportation Corridor Agency Board of Directors previously approved the engagement of an experienced issues management and consensus building firm with knowledge of the region to conduct a community ascertainment study. The purpose of the study was to gather stakeholder input to gain insight into how best to work collaboratively to address issues and improve mobility within South Orange County and throughout the region. Sharon Browning and Associates was hired in May of 2015, and the study was completed in December 2015. Sharon is here today to present the findings of the community ascertainment study to the Foothill Eastern Board of Directors. Sharon.
Sharon, welcome, and I'll let you know that I could hear Mike fine, but Chuck's a little older than I am, so we use
what?
Outside voice.
I will, and if as I speak, if any of you can't hear me, just pull on your ear or wave, and I will adjust my volume to try to adjust to your hearing. I'm excited to be here this morning. I feel, I said this before in front of the Mobility Task Force, I feel like a racehorse who has just a whole lot of information that I want to share with the hope of possibly making this an experience for everyone that can help move the ball forward in some direction regarding South County mobility. So thank you for this opportunity to be here today to present the findings. It has been a very interesting and challenging experience for me to take on this assignment. Challenging because there are layers of very complex issues that need to be addressed, and there are a wide variety of community perspectives about those specific issues. So that requires multiple layers of thinking about a multi-dimensional challenge as opposed to a couple of dimensions for the challenge. The information that you read in the report today may be new to some of you. I'm very aware that some of you may say, I already know this information. What I believe is different about this report attempts to share the information with you through the lens of consensus. What would it take to achieve consensus? What would it take to collaborate together? And hopefully through that lens, this information will take on new meaning to everyone that hears it. I'm aware that the board has had an opportunity to receive and read the report, but that the public only received the report just as you came in today. So I'm going to try as best I can to provide the detail that will help the public catch up, get us all on the same page. I will be working between the report and the PowerPoint. And when I move to the report, I will let you know what page I'm reading from so that hopefully we can start to get all of us the same kind of information as we move forward.
Chair, if I may interrupt just so everybody understands, whatever we have back here is also on the screen in front. So board members, you're able to see the same thing either way. Thank you.
This report really attempts to answer the question, do we have anything to talk about in a collaborative manner about addressing South County mobility issues? And if we do, how might we go about having that discussion? Those are the questions that led the TCA to decide that it wanted to engage a consultant with consensus planning experience to assist the agency in that process. I want to emphasize that this report is just a very small step in the direction of a multi-pronged effort that the agency is undertaking. It in no way is an effort to identify solutions that should be pursued. It is all about trying to convey to everyone what is the community's perspective on the South County mobility issues, where is their agreement, where is their lack of agreement, and how might we engage in a collaborative process. So please, as we look at this information today, it is not about moving into solutions. So with those opening comments, and Wendy to help me get through these slides, I'm working here, here, and here, so let's see how well I can do. Let's start a little bit with the background. And you can see that the State Route 241 has been part of transportation planning since 1981. Most recently, in 2014, OCTA included it in the long-range transportation plan. 2015, it's included in the Federal Transportation Improvement Program. In 2016, the SCAG Draft RTP Sustainable Communities Strategy included it. So part of the context is that this road is part of planning for some time. 8 years ago, as Mike said, in 2008, the California Coastal Commission denied the coastal consistency permit for what was then referred to as the Green Alignment. Had that alignment been completed, it would have completed the southern section or segment of the 241. Since 2008, the TCA has continued its research and planning to identify an alignment that might be able to achieve consensus among the various stakeholders. Then in May of 2015, Sharon Browning and Associates, that would be me, was retained as an independent consultant to design, conduct a community ascertainment study that focused specifically on the community's perspective. At this point, I would like to say that the agency has really allowed me a free hand in how I designed this project. I believe I said that to the interviewees. I determined what the questions were. I determined how many interviewees would be involved when we had talked with enough people. And the agency said, I want an independent assessment that will give us an accurate, candid read on what the community is thinking. I believe that they provided an atmosphere where that could happen. and I'm hoping that as you see the results of the report today, you will see those concepts that were reflected in the interviews also reflected in the report. The purpose of the study, as Mike said, was to gather insight and input from the community's perspective about how can we best collaborate regarding South County issue, mobility issues. Specifically, what the report focused on is the community's definition of the mobility challenges, what the community might establish as priorities to be considered in building consensus, and the community's preferences for how we might work together in a collaborative way in order to resolve the mobility issues. The methodology that I attempted to set up was, and I hope the interviewees experienced this, an environment with the interviewees that was objective, respectful, and inclusive. The study consisted of a series of one-on-one interviews. I requested of the agency what I call a starter list of names that I might begin with. I asked that that starter list be comprised of people who were supportive of the extension of the toll road in the past, those people who were not supportive of the toll road in the past, and also individuals that they did not know where they came down regarding the concept of a toll road. I began to interview with individuals, and then each interviewee I asked, do you have names of other people that I might contact who might be willing to engage in this kind of a back and forth dialogue? As a result of that, we did move out and identify new individuals to participate in this study. We had, there were 64 people that I reached out to. I eventually decided to include in the study 45 in-person interviews with residents and active community leaders throughout South Orange County cities and the unincorporated areas. You will note that I did not include intentionally currently elected officials or major media representatives because the goal in the study was to really have as true and pure as possible input from the community about how they perceive the issues and what needs to be thought about regarding the purpose of the study. Of those 19 individuals that did not participate in the study, they either did not respond to my request that they have an interview, they declined, or they canceled the interview with me. I want to publicly thank the 45 study participants, some of whom showed up today, so thank you very much, for participating in this study. They all represent diverse backgrounds and perspectives. They risked to be involved. This was a cold call. They didn't know I was going to call them. They picked up the phone or they got an email, and this woman, Sharon Browning, was there saying, I'd like to talk to you. They were willing to trust and give time to this. Every single one of the 45 interviews I had, I left saying it was worth my time being there. They were authentic, passionate, collegial. Some of them worked me very hard during the interview, but I believe that that came from a perspective that they wanted to serve their community, protect their community. Every single person that I spoke with was value added, and I just think we owe them all a debt of gratitude for being willing to engage in this process and hopefully open it up to some new perspective. So those 45 interviewees, I engaged in one-on-one confidential interviews. They understood that their input would go into a study, that I would not quote them or attribute any information to them, and that I wanted to have a discussion with them, a back-and-forth dialogue about a number of topics. Those topics, for those of you who have your reports, I've outlined them more on page 4, where you can really see how the questions were articulated. But generally, what we talked about is, did they believe there is or is not a mobility challenge related to the I-5? If they did believe there was a challenge, I asked them to describe the problem as clearly as they could to me, what streets, what locations, and how did they experience the problem? Why was it a problem to them? I then asked, we can have problems. Is it worth trying to solve them? Should we look for a solution, or do we want to just live with this problem? For those who want to find a solution, they then engage in suggesting the kinds of solutions we might look at. That would be with or without the toll road. They had the option of saying, I don't think the toll road should even be included in any kind of a solution that we look at. And then ask them to talk specifically about toll roads. What are their thoughts about toll roads? We then talked about priorities. If we're going to solve the I-5 congestion issues, what should be our priorities? What should we try to achieve with any kind of a solution that we look at? Because if you set priorities, they can help become criteria for you, and then you can begin to measure the solutions that you consider against these priorities. We then talked about who should be involved, in what way, for a public process that would be viewed as credible. And then we talked about, do we care about consensus? Should consensus be something that we strive for, or is it irrelevant? Is it not important for us to even be talking about a collaborative process? In terms of the content analysis or the methodology that I used, every interviewee, when I was through with that interview, I did a content analysis on that individual interview. I then merged the analysis of all 45 interviews, did a second analysis, and in that second analysis, in my opinion, well-defined categories of information emerged. There was a sufficient repeat pattern among the various areas of agreement and areas of lack of agreement that I felt the sample size was sufficient to provide limited but reliable conclusions and first step recommendations. And that was my assignment, was to really look at, is there anything to talk about, and what would be a first step in moving forward? A couple of key terms that we need to talk about here. Originally, my assignment was to determine, can we have consensus? You will see in the report that I do not refer to any consensus findings. The reason for this is, in this report, I define consensus as everybody agrees. So in order for me to present you with a consensus finding, all 45 participants would have to agree on a particular topic. I define consensus that way because consensus is about including every thought. If there's only one person that has that thought, I don't diminish it just because there's only one and there's not 50 on the other side. When you're looking to collaborate, you look at every piece of input and you see how can we problem solve in including that. Well, in my interview process, very early in the interview process, I encountered a wrinkle, a challenge I've never had before. I had some interviewees who indicated they did not want to answer the question, is there an I-5 capacity problem? And the reason they did not want to answer that question was because they did not want in any way to add credence to a decision that the 241 should be extended. So I had to make a critical path decision at that point in my study. Would I include that person's or those persons' information in this study or not? And I made the decision that it was important to include that input because those individuals are key leaders in the community, and I would not be bringing to you a reliable report if I did not do that. Therefore, you will see the study findings do not refer to any consensus findings. Because by definition, if I didn't have all 45 agreeing to a particular topic, we would not have consensus. And we want to include this information, even of those people who are categorically opposed to any extension of the road. Therefore, I refer to in the report, relative to the findings, areas where there is high agreement and areas where there is lack of agreement. And areas of high agreement are defined as where there are 40 people or more who agree on a particular topic. Lack of agreement refers to levels of agreement or disagreement below the number of 40. I think that sets a very high standard for any findings that I present to you that have a high correlation of agreement. It also gives respect to those areas where there are lack of agreement. I was asked, why didn't you categorize the areas of lack of agreement? Why didn't you say there were is high, medium, and low? I didn't want to do that because I wanted to avoid any tendency to attribute right or wrong to any input that was received, to avoid using this report to justify decision-making related to potential solutions. I wanted to create an opportunity where all interested, the input from all interested parties could be included and we could begin to focus on those areas of agreement. So as we look at the findings in a few minutes, we need to remember that we've got high areas of agreement, lack of agreement. We're interested in looking at, do we have anything to talk about? What are those areas where we might have agreement? Another lens that will be important for us all to consider as we look at the findings relate to the environment that existed while I was conducting these interviews. And you will see that during that time, there was construction on the I-5 being carried on by Caltrans. Also, the county completing the extension of La Pata between Ortega and Pico. All of the interviewees indicated that this construction had to be somehow factored into my comments to the findings of the study because it complicated their ability to state definitely at this time the level and the nature of the problem that might exist. So as we do look at the findings, as we begin to look at what might be some first steps we would take, we must keep forefront in our mind that those projects exist. Some of the interviewees said, I don't know, maybe I think there's congestion because I've got all that construction, and once the construction's gone, I won't think there's congestion. Maybe once the construction's done, there won't be congestion. And others are saying, but by hunch, there's going to be congestion, so we need to talk about congestion. So we just need to factor that because this is a dynamic environment. We need to see many moving pieces as we try to determine how can we move forward here. Also in the environment, I was struck with how busy people are in the South County. I do a number of these studies, and this by far is a locale where people are on the go constantly. I was doing interviews on Saturdays at 7 o'clock in the morning, interviews in the evening, many interviews on lunch, at lunchtime, because people are so busy with a myriad of work, family, travel, exercise, and community commitments that it was hard to get these meetings scheduled. I heard stories about if you want to get information out, you need to put your information on a little flyer and hang it on somebody's door, because that way they have to turn the handle to get in the room and they'll have to look at what's on there and maybe you can get their attention. I heard from people running campaigns saying they were frustrated that they couldn't get to people, so they would literally wait in communities for when people came home from their carpool so they might be able to catch people in the driveway as well as people coming home from work. I heard one of the words that came up, I look at what words come up amongst all of the interviews, busy, not a lot of time, came up a lot. Why this is important is because of the many issues, the complicated issues that need to be addressed. We need to have time with people and attention with people if we want to have a collaborative process, if we want to build together a solution that may be inclusive and work for everyone. That will be a challenge for the agency in terms of defining how do we get to these very busy people and get them the kind of information that they need so they can be informed and make meritorious decisions. Then finally, as part of the environment that we have to factor into looking at these findings is the local cultural and political perspective. And with that, I would like to ask if I can read, I will read, it's on page 6 of the report. I would like to read to you my description of those values, only because I put a lot of time into trying to really describe what I think I heard, and even using some of the quotes, the paraphrases, and the words. to try to breathe life into this for everyone who needs to look at this local cultural values. So starting on page 6, long and passionately held cultural and political values, perspectives, and practices are identified by interviewees as factors that will impact achieving consensus solutions to South County mobility needs. Interviewees indicate that residents and leaders in South County cities care passionately about their local community, preserving its existing character and identity, and actively organized to influence elected officials' decisions about its future. Residents and leaders are described as holding strong views about roads, modes of transportation, environmental preservation, development, and they will turn officials out of office if they do not comply with their specific wishes. Interviewees describe effective, organized, robust, and sometimes rough and tumble campaigns to elect city council majorities of pro or no development perspective and campaigns to influence what city projects are and are not approved. The words used most often to describe the local decision-making process were polarized and politicized. Interviewees also described frustration with having to live with decisions made by elected officials who, while in office, made decisions counter to the interviewee's philosophy and perspective. Thus, development and transportation planning in the South County is described as a continual tug-of-war among various factions, resulting in planning decisions that are sometimes not fully implemented, short-term, fragmented, and inconsistent due to changing council majorities and philosophies. And finally, South County residents and leaders are described as embracing the values of the right to engage in the democratic process. They value open, transparent government and decision-making and the importance of facilitating broad community input. So this, through the eyes of the interviewees, really begins to describe the social and political environment that these very complicated issues will need to be considered. So through these lenses of high agreement, lack of agreement, that we have existing construction on the I-5 and Lapata, that we have busy people out in the community, and we have a highly polarized, politicized environment. Now let's take a look at some of the findings that came out of the interviews. First, we found that there is high agreement, that is 40 or more, that an I-5 mobility problem exists. The problem relates to congestion on the I-5, and the details of the problem depend upon the location, the personal use patterns, and the needs of the individual interviewee. That means if I'm an interviewee, I might describe that there is congestion at Ortega in the I-5 because that's where I live and that's what I use. Someone else might describe that there is congestion at the I-5 in Hermosa because that's where they live. Somebody that goes north on the freeway may describe that's what the problem is. Someone that goes south on the freeway may describe that is what the problem is. So when we try to then define a problem where we're trying to solve it collectively, and there are many different perspectives about that problem, what you try to do is identify what is the collective definition of the problem. We can't just say the problem is only here at the corner of Ortega and the I-5. To solve the problem for everybody in a collaborative way, we have to have a collective definition of the problem. So the collective definition that emerged through these interviews was that there is intermittent I-5 congestion. It's not 24/7. It's happening at certain times. It's excessive congestion both north and south on the freeway from Oso Parkway to Christina's Road during a.m., p.m. Peak traffic times. It exists on the weekends, starting early on Friday afternoon and going all the way through Sunday. And there is difficulty in accessing and crossing the I-5 during the peak transportation times and when there are accidents. So what we have so far now is we have a high agreement that there is a congestion problem, and we have a collective definition of what that problem might look like. So we can have a problem, but if we don't care about the problem and we don't think we need to solve the problem, then we can stop right there. So then the question is, are there consequences to this problem, and why do we care? So then the question was asked of the interviewees, if this is a problem, what makes it a problem for you? And they identified basically six areas of how this congestion is impacting their lives. And these are listed on page 8 of the report, and I'm going to talk through them a little bit because I'd like to share with you some of the quotes that really breathe life, for me anyway, into these impacts. First of all, interviewees expressed that they have reduced personal time. Comments included, I waste hours of time just sitting in traffic. I don't get home until very late. I sit for 10 minutes just to get to the freeway some mornings, and then I sit some more. So if you go back and you remember, these are very busy people. Time means everything to them. They're extraordinarily busy. And yet now, every minute on the freeway really begins to take away from that limited time that they have. They also talked about increased personal stress, saying, not knowing if I will be able to get home or not. I feel stranded, held hostage to the I-5, late to dinner or the kids' programs, exhausted when I finally reach home. I was impressed by having it through the eyes of the interviewees, really understanding that a lot of people are moving to the South County because of the quality of life there. They are paying extra money to go there. They are doing that for their kids, to give their kids the kind of life that they want their kids to have. So there are a lot of two-parent working families so that they can afford to do this. And not being able to get around, not being able to get back to your kids, is creating a stress for them that is above and beyond what they would expect for the quality of life that they are attempting to achieve. Also, they talked about that their life choices are effective. Examples are, we changed churches because we couldn't get to worship and participate in its community life. We can't do dinner or a movie or the beach when we want. Our choices are based on traffic. I talked about increased residential cut-through traffic. People are finding their way through our neighborhood to avoid the freeway. They drive fast. They don't care about our neighborhood. It's impacting our property values. We love it here, but we're talking about moving. What I think is interesting and important to think about is a number of the interviewees said, I don't think there's congestion on the I-5 because I know how to work around it. When there's congestion, I know the side roads. And Sharon, everybody knows the side roads. So we don't need to do anything about this. But here you can see where one person's solution becomes another person's problem. That's why when you're looking to have a collaborative process, you want to look at what is the collective definition of the problem. So for me to say it's no problem, I can drive through that other person's area. For that person, we don't have a solution. Another impact, a consequence of the congestion is increased safety concerns. Comments are, I worry about fire. You can survive an earthquake, but need to get away from a fire. If my child needs a doctor, I want to be able to get him there before it's too late. We have to have another way out. What I expected to hear was still concern about San Onofre. I heard very little about that. And what I heard more regarding safety is when there are those personal emergencies that come into everyone's life, what is going to be happening at that particular time, and will I be able to get for my family, again, people looking at doing the best for their families, will I have the infrastructure that I need to meet those emergencies when they occur? And then finally, the impact, why some people care, is constrained business. Everything falls apart if my deliveries are late. Time is money to me. I can't be late to meetings. I need to make a living. Any one of these impacts might not be important to any one person. When you look at them collectively, they then begin to describe a quality of life, and then you move into what is the role of government in terms of that quality of life. I don't have an answer to that, but that's going to be one of the policy issues that will need to be addressed as this whole question of congestion has to be looked at from any kind of a leadership perspective. So, where are we? We agree, have a high level of agreement, there's a problem. We have a collective definition of the problem, and we have a reason why we should care about this problem, at least in a number of people's perspective, if we are looking for a collaborative process. Then we need a solution to the problem. And I am here to say that there is absolutely no agreement to what the solution to that problem should be. But we take heart because there is some area of agreement. But there is an area where there is not agreement. The definition of an issue is when two or more people disagree and an action has to be taken. You and I can disagree for a long time if we don't have to take an action in some way, but the minute we have to come up with a solution or an action, that's when an issue gets created, just like that. That's when you have to decide, will that solution threaten me? Will it hurt me? Is it against my principles? So we would expect that this is going to be the area that we are going to have to focus on if we want to build consensus or if we want to work collaboratively together. So let's take a look now at the thinking on what solutions might be acceptable. First of all, there is a group of the interviewees who indicate that the solution should not include increasing road capacity in any way. I believe all of these interviews come from a principled base. They are thoughtful, they are professional, and they have really built an understanding of what they perceive is the best way to go about this. Individuals who do not want to increase road capacity indicate that they want to limit the capacity because that way we can limit overdevelopment. And they make the distinction between development and growth, which is an acceptable thing, and overdevelopment. And these individuals believe that the South County has become overdeveloped. So they want to limit capacity so that no more development can occur. And they believe that any increased capacity benefits developers and new residents at the expense of existing residents. There were other interviewees who are really concerned that it's important that we begin to look at alternative modes of transportation, alternative modes of meeting our mobility needs. Those individuals are really saying that if we create more road capacity, we won't be looking seriously at those alternative modes of transportation, and that's an important thing to be happening at this point in time. They also believe that if you increase the congestion, if you allow it to just get really pretty awful, then people, being the inventive people that they are, will start to look at different kinds of transportation, and leaders, the elected leaders, will start to lead towards those different kinds of transportation, whether that's monorail, trains, buses, bicycles, walking, motorcycles, whatever. That there is an opportunity, if you increase the congestion, to start to look at what those alternative modes might be and to take make those discussions seriously. Again, this is a policy issue as to how those who are elected are going to begin to manage these valid and important considerations. So on the one side, we have people who do not want to increase road capacity. On the other side, we have people who believe that road capacity should be increased. They believe that that is important for the health, well-being, and safety of existing residents, that leaders have allowed congestion to build for too long, and that existing residents are paying the price for this. They believe that growth will occur and that plans are needed to accommodate the growth in order to avoid gridlock, a degraded quality of life, and unnecessary tragedies. These people, again, are ones saying, I paid a lot of money to come here. I understood roads would be built. I understood I could get my kids to school, that the school would be located next to this road. So I made a lot of life decisions based on those plans. And I want to see those plans go forward. These individuals also believe they have a right to cars, that they like cars, and they should be able to have that choice. So you see that the broad range of perspective on this whole question, do we increase road capacity or not, will become a very important area for discussion, collaborative discussion, if we are to move this discussion forward in any way. The next area we looked at and considered was, should toll roads be a part of the congestion solution or not? And out of that discussion emerged five issues, and those issues for any productive discussion in a collaborative mode are probably going to have to be addressed one way or another. So let's talk about those a little bit, and those appear on page 9 of the report if you are following it. And I'd like to talk about each of those a little bit. First of all, the issue, are toll roads desirable? And are they value added or not? Some interviewees are accepting of toll roads. They believe they're the only way to finance new roads in California. They view the existing toll roads as well designed, enjoyable to drive, reduce stress, save time. They provide choice. They create additional capacity on other roads. They view the fees as temporary and necessary when state funding is limited and not available. They are accepting of the user fee, and they believe that those who can pay for the choice of services should be allowed to do that. Interviewees on the other spectrum indicate that they are philosophically opposed to the toll road concept. They believe that public roads should be for everyone, not just the elite, or those who have the money and can afford to pay to drive them. They do not view the fee as temporary and believe that the TCA will never pay off the debt. TCA will never give up the revenue it needs to stay in business, and that the toll roads facilitate developers. Over development and growth, they degrade and geographically divide the local community. So this whole question of the role of toll roads in the solution, again, comes to a policy discussion. About how do we begin to manage these expectations and varied perspectives. The next issue that emerged was the question of the financial sustainability and viability of toll roads. Some interviewees indicate that no one uses the roads. Two-thirds of the roads are empty all of the time. The roads are money losers. They will not pencil. The taxpayers pay for the road and then have to pay to use the road. And that most people will not use the road when they can use another road for free. Those thinking on the opposite end of that poll indicate that they don't have a good understanding of the toll road economics. They do believe it's important to have fiscal responsibility and that any roads should pencil and you should be able to deliver on the financial expectations that are set, but they believe the fee is reasonable and they're happy to pay the fee in order to use the road. So again, another area that will need to be looked at in order for constructive discussions to go forward. Then there's a question about the TCA's ability to lead in a fair and unbiased manner. Some interviewees believe that the TCA has an inherent conflict of interest given their mission statement, and therefore they should not be the only person making the decision about whether or not a toll road exists or not exists. They say that the TCA's mission's reason for being is to build and manage toll roads. They would say the toll road is needed just to justify their continued existence, and that they represent the developers' interests. So this whole question of can the TCA be unbiased in making a decision about is there really a need for this toll road or not is part of the question that will need to be addressed. On the other end of the perspective here, we all had interviewees who believe that the TCA is comprised of elected officials who directly represent them. So again, it's going back to the democratic process. They feel they are represented here. They accept the needs for roads financed by and led by the Joint Powers Authority. They have confidence in the research and information of the TCA agency and its board of directors. These interviews believe that decision-making process would benefit from the involvement of other planning agencies such as Caltrans and Orange County Transportation Planning Authority because they would like to see all of this planning done in a coordinated way. But they are very comfortable with the TCA making this decision, would like to see it augmented by the input from the other planning agencies. Final one is the alternative 241 road extension alignments. If it is decided that the 241 is going to be extended, there is high understanding. I'm not saying high acceptance here because I want to remain true to my interviewees as best I can, but there's high understanding. Everyone understands that if the road is extended, it must connect back to the I-5 at some place. Somewhere, that connection needs to reoccur. Where there is disagreement is about where that connection would occur and how it would occur. Just a whole range of interesting ideas, some that I didn't even understand because the interviewees had more planning experience than I did. But some wanting the 241 to just stop at Ortega, leave it there. Others wanting to go back and taking another look at the green alignment and finding some way to take the alignment down south of San Clemente. And others really talking about finding some place between San Juan, San Clemente, thinking about tunneling. How could you tunnel to connect? Just a whole range of ideas. So these are a range of ideas that will need to be looked at and considered if the decision is made to proceed in pursuing extension of the road. And then finally, the issue that came up that I'd like to describe is road capacity enhancement planning. And I'll read from the page again. There's high agreement among interviewees that if extension of the 241 road is considered, it should be considered in conjunction with ancillary road improvements. The interviews all believe that the ultimate best solution may be a combination of other capacity improvements along with the 241. They would like to know that there is a comprehensive planning approach that takes into the planning that OCPA is doing, that Caltrans is doing, and what San Diego is doing. So that, in other words, if we do go ahead and we do have an extension of the 241, that they have confidence that it has been a comprehensive planning effort and it will really make a difference.
Chair, if I may interrupt just for a second, just to give you an idea of where you are. You're doing a great job and the voice level is perfect. We're about 50 minutes into a two-hour meeting and page 11 to 23, just so you keep all track right. of where you are. We want to give plenty of time for questions and comments from the board and the public vote.
That is very helpful to me. So I'm going to move ahead and not read some of this information. Moving on then to if we have a problem, what kind of criteria might we use for solving that problem? You will see here on the screen and those the priorities that came out of the interview process, and those are listed on page 11 of the report. They are basically quality of life, a balanced environmental sensitivity approach, credible, cost-efficient, coordinated transportation planning and management, public safety, and meaningful proven traffic reliefs and benefits. On those pages, I define through the voices of the interviewees how each of those categories might more discreetly be defined if you were to go into some sort of a collaborative process. Then moving on to the question, is consensus possible or desirable? Again, there was lack of agreement about either the value or the feasibility of consensus. And I heard comments such as, where would we begin? What we know is fighting things through city council. We're polarized. That makes consensus difficult. Some interviewees indicated that consensus was irrelevant because the toll road is just not going to happen. Some thought it would be nice to stop fighting, that consensus might lead to something getting done. And then again, you see the belief in the democratic process, individuals saying, you know, higher-ups just need to tell us what to do. The county should make sure we have the roads because they allow the growth. And this, it's a state road. The state should just come in and tell us what to do. So generally, I'm not really perceiving a consensus as possible, a value added, and really, again, looking back to the democratic process and their elected officials as those individuals that should really take this collaborative process on. There's high agreement that surf riders should be involved in any kind of decision-making process. They must be part, they must be consulted, they are a given. And all interviewees really indicate they have different feelings about surf riders and environmental groups, but see them as credible. They have protected the environment and they need to be a part of any consensus process. Also, high agreement that the public process needs to involve full public review, access to information, and choices at the local level. Very important that there are choices at the local level. Where the community wants to be involved, if the 241 is to be part of the solution, the community wants full information about alignment, location, and connecting, design connections with the I-5, full access to studies and analysis that will be used for decision making. They want to be involved in design considerations, mitigations, environmental impacts, and there is strong point of view that eminent domain is not an acceptable action as part of a solution. Again, you can turn to pages 15 and 16. On those two pages, I summarize all of the areas of agreement and all the areas of lack of agreement. I think if you just look at those and begin to sit with those a little bit, they begin to start to tell you a little bit about what we're dealing with here. Many of those are policy issues, philosophical issues. Many are technical and design issues. And when you're going into a collaborative process, if you can begin to separate those out, not conflate them, and very often in public meetings they become conflated, so if you can separate them out, there will be an opportunity, I think, for the dialogue to be a little different if you can take that approach. So in conclusion, quickly running here, my sense is that community consensus is not a realistic goal, that a high level of collaborative problem solving may be possible, that elected officials have the greatest potential to do that problem solving, that surf rider environmental groups will need to be involved, that open, transparent public process will be essential, that we need to expect that there will be contentious, intense public debate, and that the willingness of the community to either support a collaborative process or not is going to be key in determining if we can succeed. And I will leave that for everybody just to think on that. In terms of recommendations, I recommend that some form of an elected official's collaborative discussion process be formed. I'm not saying who should be involved in that or how, but that needs to occur at an elected level. That process needs to be augmented by having Caltrans, OCTA, and San Diego planners intimately involved. That the approach that group looks at needs to be comprehensive. It needs to consider the extension of the 241 in a broader context of solutions, including even alternative modes of transportation, and that group can begin to build on the areas of high agreement and the areas of lack of agreement to initiate their discussions. Again, there needs to be an open, transparent link to the community. I recommend that there is a public information and communication plan that is open, fact-based, and ongoing, that we provide feedback to those people who participated in the study, and that's why you were invited, and that's why I thank you for being here, because this is a first step of maybe doing business a little bit differently than we have in the past. I recommend that you have a public information form that launches any process that you might have, This would be a major forum where elected officials, as well as the public, would come. You would all hear together for the first time, what are the plans of OCTA, San Diego planners, Caltrans. You would look at alternative modes of transportation. What does the future really say about those modes of transportation? How can they be integrated? There would be an opportunity for the public to add to the priorities talked about here today and alternative solutions. Basically, I'm saying very often forums occur after elected officials have already decided on the solutions, so then we hear from the community in reaction, as opposed to the community providing the elected officials with their input up front, so those can early in the process be included in the problem solving. Finally, I recommend that there be some methodology for working with surf riders and environmental organizations. I recommend that you consider forming an ad hoc community group that would be allowed to give input to your public involvement program on an ongoing basis. Very often public involvement programs are designed and then they are laid down and they're static. They don't adjust to the dynamic situation and the changing needs of the public. If we had ongoing information from the public, they might help us carry out a more effective and responsive planning effort. And finally, I think it's going to be very important to go back and re-engage everyone who participated in this process around the time of the green alignment. Some people are jaded, they're tired, they care, and I think there's a responsibility here to go back out and actively re-engage them. And this did take a long time, and thank you for helping me get there. And now I will open it up.
Hey, let's start by appreciating all the work that you did. Okay, let me recommend this. We have about an hour left, and since 2020 is perfect vision and we want to see clearly, how about we start with 20 minutes from the directors, up to 20 minutes, and if there are more questions, we've run out of 20 minutes, I'm the director, I'm going to stop us short. We'll go 20 minutes worth of public time, and then after that, I'm going to stop you short at 20 minutes and leave 20 minutes for some question and answer. What I'd like to encourage is that we are both asking questions of Sharon Browning and of the work that she's done here, so that'll be the parameters for the comments. With that, Director Spitzer, you said that you had a comment?
And yeah, just real quick. Sharon, thank you. I've worked with you for 20 years. I mean, you did a lot of our collaboratives with the Board of Supervisors for years, right? So when I heard that you were selected for this process, I was like, man, awesome, because I know that you have a tremendous amount of credibility, and that's demonstrated here. I'm not surprised when I got a private, I'm on the committee, I missed it, but I got a catch up. And I wasn't, when I read it, a lot of the findings and some of the statements, especially about how the public feels about their elected officials, stung a little bit. But I'm not surprised because those of us who went through El Toro know what this community is. I mean, we stopped an airport. I mean, this community does not mess around. This is not a, you know, this is a community that is squared away. And they know how to engage. So when I read this, I was at first taken aback, but then I was like, this is completely consistent with other battles we've had in this county. So the thing I want to ask you is, while you were speaking, this document that's been distributed to us, is this the official public document?
Yep.
Okay.
That's it.
All right. So I did a line-by-line comparison between the draft I was provided and the one that's now the public document. And it's identical except for one area. And that is, and it goes to methodology, the methodology section. Mm-hmm. And given my background, I'm very concerned about everything you said and potential bias. I mean, one of the reasons I think we went through this exercise is to immediately say to people, which is great, hey, we're open, we want to hear what the public has to say, and there's a process that's got to be collaborative. I just wanted you to explain that we do not have a list of the interviewees. The promise was no attribution, but I think it's fundamental to understand who they are so that when you initiate a report, everybody can see you did a fair and representative sample. Now, in my draft, it was represented and it was deleted in the final. On page 4, it says, quote, interviewees were informed, okay, so not a gotcha, that while their names would be listed in an appendix to the ascertainment study report, their interview input would remain confidential.
Right.
That part stayed in, the interview would be confidential. Right. But the answer, but the names listed and so their affiliation is deleted.
You're right. So would you like to answer that question, and then I will amplify.
Sure. When Sharon set up the process and she talked to them, the way it was presented to the people was exactly how you described, but it was not disclosed to them that we would be making the report a public document. So kind of because we hadn't asked the question exactly like that, that is why the names were not provided. However, if there would be, say, for example, a Freedom of Information Act or a FOIA for that information, it is public information that, if requested, would be provided.
Okay, so let me comment on this and I'm done. Look, out of the gate, the importance of this report was to send a very loud and clear message about rules of engagement and how we are going to get things done. Mm-hmm. If there was any miscommunication to anybody whatsoever about how it would be and how names would be revealed, that's a stutter step that you don't want to start this discussion with. I would hope, and you can't demand it, but as a courtesy to those people, they should be recommunicated with. I think it would be certainly, I don't need to know what anybody said. But I was under the belief when I got briefed that at least we would know who and their affiliation. You know, but somebody, I know their name, South Orange County, you know, Chamber of Commerce or business. So we could say, hey, look, of the, what'd you interview, 45?
45.
Yeah, of the 45, it was balanced, right? So that's my only point. Mm-hmm. Somehow we need to fix that to the best of our ability. So when the report is examined, people can know that we did the best, Sharon did the best she could to make sure it was balanced. Mm-hmm. Right now, the report, no one would know how it got formed. So that's my major point.
I understand.
Let's start this right about how we put it on the
board. I think that's a decision you will all have to decide how to proceed on. What right. I did say to the interviewees, I wouldn't quote you. I would list your name at the end of the report. At that time, I did not know. And I even told you that. I don't know if you'll even get to hear or see this report. How it has progressed as the agency has really moved forward wanting to get this information out. But I had not asked for your permission to make this a whole public document. So we may have to deal with that.
I think what we would do is we'll reach back through Sharon to the interviewees and just clarify and get their feedback. And then at that point, maybe even amend the report to add that information if they're amenable to that.
Yep.
Okay, but to your point, I'm done. You said if we got a public record, it's not a FOIA, it's a PRA. If we got a PRA, we would, quote unquote, have to disclose it.
And
all I'm saying is, if that is true, then we had a responsibility to let people know that their interview would be disclosed ultimately. You can't, in order to maintain this agency's credibility about a process, everybody needs to know from the get-go what the rules are, because to the reason we did this report in the first place was to establish credibility. And if the rules are not consistent, you cut against the thing that you were striving to do in the first instance.
Yes.
I'm done.
Okay. And then I would say, this is if a collaborative process needs to be iterative. You know, we are, if we're doing anything different this time, everybody's going to learn. It's not going to be perfect. You know, it's got to be communicating all the time and adjusting all the time. It seems to me, I think if I talk to most of the interviewees, you would say, okay, let my name be public. That's what I bought for. But I don't want to assume that. You know, I don't want to go in and assume that without asking you, because that isn't what I said to you before we had the interview. So I think it was on the side of being abundantly cautious about how I had represented it, because frankly, I have never had an ascertainment study before that has been made public, where the participants have been invited to come for the first unveiling of it. So this is new territory for us. But I think we can move ahead and deal with that.
Good. Very good.
Okay?
Appreciate it.
It's got to be iterative, Supervisor. Nobody's perfect here. This feedback's real important. I'm glad the interviews are here. We're going to have to grapple with this. And if we want to make this a collaborative process, we're all going to have to think the best and try to make it work. We need to do that, I think. And I do.
All right, Director Sacks, and then Ferguson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First, I need to advise you that I'm not winking at you. I enjoy hot peppers in my omelet, and I made the mistake just now of touching my eye. So this is not a tearful question. Back to the environmental aspects of the study, and I'm not going to ask you to try to interpret how well the interviewees did with eliminating some of the environmental aspects in their mind. Mm-hmm. That would be unfair to them. But based on your experience in doing these things, and as you meted through this report and your processes, was there anything that stood out to you that may have been, thank you, anything that may have been different in your mind if there were no construction going on, if there weren't these delays going on?
I think I can say to you what the interviewee said. If they weren't going on, it would be less complicated for them to talk about the kind of congestion they're experiencing. That would have been different. If those projects didn't exist and they weren't anticipating how much will that reduce congestion and so forth, they could have been clearer about what their point of view was on it. What I think was very clear is they felt those projects need to be factored into any decision-making process. So,
right, but you did also state that there were some that did not want to discuss the congestion or non-congestion aspect whatsoever. Mm-hmm.
They did not want to even answer, is there a congestion problem? Because coming into the interview, they do not want extension of the 241 even considered.
Right.
And so they did not want to be compromised in contributing to any process that would result in its being extended. And I then had to make a decision. Am I going to exclude these people?
No, I appreciate so that, that's, your position.
So those are two different questions.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you for your answer. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Absolutely. Director Ferguson and Director Berger.
Yes, I have
can you all hear?
A couple of comments.
And nice and loud.
And one question, and I'll speak as loud as I can. I have limits to my voice, so I'll do the best I can. First of all, I appreciate the balance in your presentation and the fact that you really strove to represent all points of view. And so I want to preface what I have to say with that. Mm-hmm. I have seen the list, I will disclose that, of people. 8 out of 10 from our community were from one faction, only 2 that represented the other side. So I just want that to be out there. Second, there's a question. From your discussions, and given the importance of environmental group buy-in to any proposal going forward, do you think there might be an advantage to securing environmental group buy-in before moving forward with further public discussions? And the reason I say that is that in my mind, a lot of the ambiguity in people's minds is tied to that environmental difficulty, and that if that could be solved, I think it would lessen the amount of controversy. So that's my question.
I definitely agree they must be involved. I think all the interviewees would agree they need to be involved proactively up front in the process. Even those interviewees who feel like they got overrun by surf riders think they need to be involved. All the interviewees believe that the surf riders and the environmental groups are value added, because we will have a sensitive environmental response if we can come up with a solution that is responsive to them. I don't have enough information to answer your question, and I'm always very careful about doing that. If I don't have facts, I'm not going to speculate. I can't say whether it should happen before. I can say it must happen up front, and it must be a part of the initial planning. That when you bring any major entity, whether it is the community, whether it's a major organization, professional organization, when you bring them in behind the curve, then you're reacting the whole time. So my answer would be, I don't know if they have to be before, but they certainly have to be upfront in the process. Regarding, I don't know who you're talking about, I have to go back to the interviewees. I don't know who was fell on what sides regarding the names of the individuals you know. But what I'm going to tell you is I had a number of people, I may have only had two, I don't know, but I suspect those people referred me to a number of other people who were not on the list that you may know, that were of their perspective. So I think we did get a pretty good sampling of what's going on. The proof is in the pudding. If all the messages are in this report, then that means we talked to the right people. The other thing I want to say is when you're approaching consensus, even if there was only one person in this assessment that represented the viewpoint from your community, if there was only one, that person's input was not diminished in this report.
That I very much appreciate.
It's included. So the whole concept of consensus is you don't exclude. It's not about more or less. It's not about the power of the majority. It's not about that. It's either the input has merit on its own or it doesn't. You separate it out from who says it when you look at it from merit. So when you operate by consensus, you protect everybody. That is my view.
Sharon, that's well said. I know those of us from the Senate Council or we sit on the Board of Supervisors, if everything has been said, it doesn't mean that everybody has to say it. So the idea that everyone is represented is a good point. Director Murphy, followed by Director Schaefer.
Thanks. Actually, some of it's already been touched on. The one piece early on from Director Spitzer that I just want to reinforce, I'm concerned anytime I hear that a request for information would get a different report or augmentation that wasn't presented just as a transparent thing from the beginning. And so I think the listing thing, while the abundance of caution in terms of credibility, I understand, I would be concerned to hear that statement again on anything related to this, because there should never be a difference between what's being presented today, even detail absent, I guess, the litigation type advice. And there's certainly none of that at this point, I would think, given it to be in a new process. So I'll leave that alone, as it was touched on. The other question, and I guess I'm following along the thoughts of others here, but that whole idea of not wanting to respond while there's construction that was mentioned earlier, would it be reasonable to assume that that's based on a logic of we don't know whether these things are going to improve things until they're done, and we have to wait even longer than that to figure that out, and hopefully we can get a slice of time where everything stops, or was there something else that was attributed to that I'm not thinking of?
All of the above. So okay. Some people were saying, gee, maybe if we wait, we'll see what will happen. Other people were saying, you know, I might be feeling like this is just more congested because of all that's going on, but I've got to tell you, besides that, I want to go ahead and answer this question because there is congestion.
Okay.
You know, there was before, there will be later, and I don't want to sit here anymore. So it's all of the above.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Director Shea, followed by Director Bartlett.
Yes, thank you, Craig. Number one, Sharon, thank you so very much. Great report. I very much appreciate all your effort in regards to the agency. I do want to say that I have to compliment our CEO, Mike Creeman, and this board for moving in a really new direction. In my opinion, I've been around a long time. I like the fact that we're doing a lot more outreach. We're really trying to bring in collaboration, bring the community to the table with us so that we can really try to solve these long-term problems that we've had. So I think this process is moving in the right direction, and Mike and all the board members need to compliment it. Just a couple things in the report. The 45 people, I know it's difficult for you to get more, I'm hearing, but does that really give us a good sample of what people are feeling out in, I mean, we have such a large community these days. Mm-hmm. Is that really a good sample? I would think you would want it to be larger.
As I said, it is limited.
Right.
But when you look at the information, the reason I decided to stop there, I could have pursued, I could have kept going. I would have taken more time, and I would have had to negotiate that, you know, with you all who are eager to get
so
going.
Financial issue.
Where was I going with that? But when you look at the information, patterns get created. When you see over 45 interviews, the same thing being said, you know that you've heard it enough that you can extrapolate. And if you took a larger sample, you could probably find that. Now, just because this is what we're finding, that's why I suggest that on the priorities,
right,
on the alignment, that you seek additional input. And that's why at an open forum, part of that agenda might be really having the people that attend that forum say, I agree with those priorities, or I would add an additional definition. This is a starting point.
So you're expanding.
You can expand from here. But what this does is it begins to give you an informed platform to begin to engage with the community as opposed to coming from a back end.
Okay. My last question is in regard to methodology, and that is that, and I understand this issue of consensus, general, you know, agreement. But for me as a board member, I would like to understand, and maybe this is more of an internal request that I would be asking, is that how many below the 40, you know, people that you spoke to, was it 36, actually a very large margin that really liked or agreed with one issue? I don't, the comparison makes it difficult for me to understand. Either it's, you know, over the 40 or the consensus wasn't, but I'd like to understand the percentages that fell within at different levels for the different questions that were asked. And Mike, is that something that we would be able to receive?
I could tell you why I didn't do that intentionally.
Yeah, well, I'll let Sharon answer first. And then
thank you. That's my last question.
The reason I intentionally did not do that, because, again, if you're looking for consensus, and I start to rank those areas where there is less agreement, then what starts to happen is people want to go, oh, well, if 36 people felt this way, we should put it over here. And so the high standard that I set for high agreement, because that's what this report is about, it's where do we agree? Because if you have enough in common where you agree, then there's a reason to sit down and start to talk. Again, I'm trying to protect those people who might not fall in that high category, so that what they have to say doesn't get lost. In subsequent conversations, in subsequent research, you can certainly do that. But what I've learned from the community in these interviews is the more we bifurcate, the more we segment the information that is coming to us, as opposed to including it and seeing if we can problem solve around it. That is what contributes to polarization. But when everybody's input somehow has a place on the table, then we can start to have discussions about what's important to people.
Well, and if I could just follow up for a
question,
then I'll let go.
Yes.
My concern is that because we do, are moving into a new year of marketing, we would want to reach out to those certain percentages that maybe are having a difficult time understanding some of these suggested, you know, objectives, and to try to maybe create more of a an ability to communicate. And so if we don't know what those percentages are, we can't really help with the educational tools that we would need. That would be my rationale of why I would have liked to have seen those breakdowns. But I appreciate what you're saying.
Good answer. All right, if I may, we have three directors, Bartlett, Boyce, and Martinez, who are in order, but we're at the 20-minute mark, and I know we're beginning to lose some of our community. Mm-hmm. And so if I may, I'll go right to you after the community, but we'll start with 20 minutes with the community. And if you would do us a favor and come right to the podium and direct your question to Ms. Browning, but make sure that the rest of us can hear as well. Is there anyone from the community who has a comment or a question, remark that you would like to make? We would love your input.
Oh, okay.
Introduce yourself.
Absolutely. Good morning, or almost afternoon. My name is Erin Kutnick. I'm an 18-year resident of San Juan Capistrano, and I participated in the study, and I have no problem having my name listed, so you can skip that phone call.
Thank you. I suspect this will be the case with most of them.
Yeah, I mean, I agreed to do it. I was called by Sharon. I don't know who gave her my name, how I got in there, but I drive for a living, and I am a former transportation commissioner. I have lived my entire life in Southern California, and I am no stranger to traffic. So maybe that is why I'm also very actively involved in my community. And so what I would just like to say is that, you know, when there has been some questions, I think really good comments here about the content of the report and the people that have been spoken to. In addressing Ms. Ferguson's comment about the 8 out of 10, I obviously have no idea who the other 44, actually I know one person, I have no idea who the other 43 were. In saying that there were potentially 10 people in San Juan Capistrano and the 8 are in a certain faction and 2 are in another faction is an interesting thing. But if you have 8 that you would possibly look at and say those are on one side of the issue and 2 on the other, that might be a representative of San Juan Capistrano. I don't think that that was an accident. I think that might be that 80% of the community is supportive of some type of a solution and on that side, and potentially 20% is not. I don't think that's a bunch of friends or something unusual. And the way I can qualify that is that when I was done with my interview, she asked me for some names of people who I thought might have input and important things to share with this study, and the names that I gave her were all people from San Clemente. And I did that intentionally of people that I knew who were very actively involved in their communities, who knew a lot about the community issues there, who were as actively involved as I was in my community, but could share another perspective. Because clearly we know, and I don't know where everyone lives, but the issues that we deal with traffic-wise in San Juan Capistrano are very different than what they do deal with in San Clemente. And so I wanted to be able to say, here are some people that I know are very in tune, they know a lot of people, people come to them with information or complaints or issues, and so reaching out to those people will give you another perspective, and you may hear things completely different than what I said, hoping to make the report the best that it could be so that you do get to talk to everyone. And then, like has been said here, if you hear the same message over and over again, you know you're getting to the people and they are telling you what you need to hear about what's going on in the community. So thank you for allowing me to be a part of it.
Sure. Thank you for doing that.
Another question from the community. And please just step up. Yeah, if you raise your hand and wait for me to call on you, you might not get here in time.
Hi, everyone. I'm Brenda Miller, San Clemente resident, founder of PEDAL. And I think it's really interesting that Sharon came up with this analogy of a racehorse, because in my opinion, she gets a triple crown. As should the board, because in my opinion, this was a scientific process. She was very diligent in making sure it was scientific. The fact that statements are unidentified makes it very scientific. And although I understand the value in revealing identity of particular statement, sources of statements, I think it's better to focus on the content of the comment and not the source of the statement, which automatically enables people, decision makers, and the public to say, okay, well, that's from that sector and that's from that sector, instead of understanding what they're saying and does it have meaning going forward. Also, a consistent theme is quality of life. And I think if we all focused on, even if you're not a pedestrian or a bicyclist or an active transportation or transit advocate, if you focus on improving the motorist's experience, that automatically means that you reduce demand. And you don't necessarily reduce demand by increasing the width of roadways, increasing the number of roadways. You do so by other means, and multimodality is a key part of that. That's a foundation congestion management plan law at the federal and state level. And also, your toll roads that do exist are not multimodal, and they need to be. Common ground, in my opinion, is easy. This is Orange County, we all get how important it is to manage taxpayers' resources efficiently. So how much money is being spent per person to move how many people? Over what period of time? And is that investment sustainable? I just got finished going over 400 or 500 pages of SCAG's RTP, line by line, annotating everything, and they consistently state that the status quo is not sustainable. You already seen in Sharon's report, people can't go to church, They change what churches they go to. That amazed me. That's important. And also another comment of this development versus no or overdevelopment perspective, I think that obscures the issue of quality of life. We can all agree no one ever says, can you imagine the ranch is going to build 10,000 more homes? Can you imagine the number of bicycles and pedestrians that are going to be out there in our system? That never happens. It's all about the car. It's all about the SOV. So let's focus on the quality of that experience, which automatically means that we entertain the variables of what SCAG has identified as 38% of all trips within the SCAG region are 3 miles or less, and 78% of those trips are made by full-size vehicles. That makes the experience of local roads miserable, and we can't get where we want to go. I'm born and raised in this county. We used to have this window of 4 or 5 hours in the middle of the day when you could go to LA or you could go to San Diego. I think we now have about 90 minutes in order to hit that window. So we need to understand that. And in conclusion, I was told by a lot of people who contacted me, they give me warning, Sharon was going to call me or email me. And they said, don't talk to her. Are you kidding? You're going to give credibility to the toll road agency and all this BS that we all hear. But obviously I didn't listen because she did speak to me. And I'm glad that she did speak to me, and I'm glad that she did have this great breadth of outreach, because I believe if we can all sit at the table, we have the capacity to enlighten each other. That's really important. And I think that's the quality of the product that she produced. And there aren't very many quasi-government agency or government agency studies that are done that have this kind of quality. And I think that's really important. And the fact that obviously you didn't have your thumb on her as a board, she had free range. And I think that speaks volumes. And I think reading between the lines here a little bit, I think you did a good job in that respect. So I'd like to see you continue with this respect. Your idea of creating an ad hoc group, if you do create an ad hoc group, and I don't mean to bash OCTA here, but one problem with their citizen advisory committees for the bicycle community is that they're very far down in the process. They're not integrated early in the design process, early in the policy process. And so their value is diminished and a lot of frustration occurs. I think if you create that ad hoc group that people be involved in the early phases, design, consultation, so they can feel like they're really vested in the process. And we're all on the same page. It doesn't matter what party you are, how skinny or fat you are, what you wear, it matters your quality of life. And so we're all in the same boat. So thank you again. Thank you to Sharon. Triple crown, everybody, you did a good job.
I have a question for clarification. It's important. Ms. Miller, I have a question for you.
Yes, sir.
Thanks for attending all my public workshops on the 3rd District bike, by the way.
Thank you for attending them in turn.
But I want to ask you a question about something you said.
Yeah.
About attribute. No, I want to clarify this because there's media in the room.
Okay.
You said that you don't think names should be put in there for purposes of attribution.
Can I
want to just clarify that.
Yeah.
We're not asking for attribution, just who was interviewed.
Okay, I think that's fair. Who was interviewed?
Not what they said. No one cares.
I want you to clarify.
That's the difference. You said for attribution.
I want to be very clear that you're very clear that we're on the same page. Don't say X person said Y comment.
No one's suggesting that.
But if you have a list of them, even though
she said that,
you know,
I want to make sure that that's not reported.
He thinks like a lawyer, does he not?
Yeah.
People know, obviously, that's like I read the RTP.
I'm going to say this, but Brenda, thank you for not listening.
All right,
very good. Thank you for bringing that up.
I just want to clarify the recommendation is to have an ad hoc community committee about the public involvement process, not about inputting any solutions that might be looked at, but the process so that the information flows.
Welcome.
Good afternoon. I have literally nothing to say after her. I mean, she just blew me away. You are so articulate. You're so thoughtful, so measured.
I don't try.
But you are, and I very much appreciate that. And I do think one of your biggest points that I can echo is just increasing the different types of transportation that we can get through at the county. I understand that that is not TCA's task at hand, but again, working with other agencies to do this. I appreciate you, Sharon, because I think had you pull out maps when you were interviewing me, and I was showing you roads, and so you were really, really thoughtful in that measure. And yeah, I think consensus is the way to go, and just thinking outside of the box is going to be very important for everyone involved. So again, just listen to what she said. She was very, very good. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Who else? Please, welcome.
Hello.
And your name, sir?
My name is Richard Gardner. I'm from Capistrano Beach.
Welcome.
Just for curiosity, I wonder how many here in the room attended the meeting in Del Mar a few years ago with the Coastal Commission. Oh, there are a couple. Well, it's because it seems like it was a century ago, but I guess it's only been a decade.
8 years.
What was it, 2006?
Eight.
My, how time flies. I appreciated the opportunity to give some input through a third party to the board, because I, over the many years, felt, and with the many meetings with the CEO, that none of my comments were going anywhere. They weren't being addressed. I don't think they were even considered at all, or that maybe members of this board at the time, although they change every couple of years, even were aware of what I was suggesting. And it kind of fits many of the categories, because I was involved in, you know, reading the EIR and looking at the number of trips per day and the transportation impacts of having the 241 South versus not, what it is now and what it'll be in 30 years with and without. When you looked at it, I think the figure was 28,000 trips per day on the last leg that heads from South Orange County, merges onto the 5 and heads south to Oceanside. And it was not clear in that analysis then what they call an origin and destination. Where are all these 28,000 trips coming from, and why are they going there? And as you look around more, you find out, well, they can't be coming from Elsinore or out that direction, like Corona, coming all the way over the, you know, over the mountain onto the 241 all the way down through Santa Margarita to get onto the 5 so they can head down to Oceanside when they could have just taken a 76. So it started making people wonder what was going into the study, you know. And then, of course, if you look at the other intersections and you see that Oso had 85,000 trips per day. Even the city of San Juan Capistrano, that had the miserable Ortega with California State Highway 74 hitting the 5 in a something that had been there since the late 50s, and we all knew had to be repaired, but it was still getting 45,000 trips per day. So with only 28,000 trips per day on a 2-4 lane highway, it just didn't make sense. It was virtually no traffic. So when you add up the economic side and say, well, they only need a 400 foot long bridge across the San Juan Creek? Or how big will a bridge be across Ortega Highway? Well, how about the Gabino Canyon? What about the Cristianitas Creek? How many bridges are going to be needed to go across all these watersheds? Not to mention the interchange down on the San Mateo. When you add them up, you go, holy smoke, that little section's going to cost more than the whole rest of the 241. Because you don't really need the bridges in the, you know, from Oso Road all the way down. So it was clear to me that financially it didn't make sense, especially not for 28,000 trips. But nobody would talk about it. I never got responses.
But it's in here now.
It's in this report, and I just got a copy. So
okay. It's something that has to be financial feasibility.
Yeah, because
has to be addressed.
Well, anyway, that was the main thing, and I think if you wanted, I mean, if you would like to see this organization continue, and some of us feel that it should be dissolved into the OCTA, and that it would be great efficiencies, but those kind of economic efficiencies would be something that a Republican governing body would make that choice and say, you know, having an additional thing here has certain advantages for local control in all these cities, but having it handled in a more efficient manner at an OCTA level has greater value to the public. So anyway, thank you.
Thank you, Richard.
Thank you for coming.
Another member from the community. We have a couple more minutes. Okay. Seeing no one yet, let's do this. We're going to bring it back to, we have about 25 minutes left. We'll try to split it between board, go back to the community again. I'm going to start with Director Bartlett.
Sharon, first of all, great job on the ascertainment study.
Thank you.
It's very, very thorough and very balanced. I think you hit the nail on the head when you said there's a consistent theme with the comments over and over again. For instance, gridlock on the freeway, trying to find a route to the 5 freeway connecting. But there's also a consistent theme with the misinformation that's out there as well about the toll roads being a burden to the taxpayers when in fact they're privately financed. So it's a lot of good information for us as board members here, because that will help us in messaging correct information to get that correct information out to the community. And then I did see that the 45 names of the participants, I think it was a very fair representation from the community at large. As you contact the participants, at this point, do you think it's advisable to add to your comments to your ascertainment study that you feel it was a fair and balanced approach with broad-based representation from the community, including, you know, residents and business organizations, nonprofits, the environmental groups, just to give people an idea of the kinds of individuals that participated in the study without posting the names. At least it gives some information about who the participants were that had the various commentary from the report.
Well, I intentionally didn't do that, but again, you're going to all have to decide how to go about it. I figured that the names would speak for themselves. I talked to some people who had points of view that you would not believe. They are members of the business community, but they have points of view that are very different than the business community. So if I give them a label, as being, you know, from a chamber of commerce or a realtor or whatever, I immediately limit how you will look at the information that they are given. First and foremost, they live in the area. They experience the problem and they care about it. They're a leader in some way. I could not hope to characterize who these people are. They may live in San Clemente, but they work in San Juan Capistrano. They may also work in Irvine. So the minute we start doing that, again, we limit how we look at the information they bring to us. I would not even venture to give you all a title. If we go out and do this and you insist upon having titles, I think you should ask them what title they want, because there's no way I could give you a title. So again, the minute we start trying to classify people, what happens is we go back into these old modes. So I intentionally, on that list, did not say where they were from, because I think, one, their names will speak for themselves. You all know who these people are. You all got referred because other people know about you, because you are having an impact, because you are viewed as credible. So I think anybody could look at this list and say, these are pretty much the right people.
Sharon, I'm not talking about specific titles per se or their organization names, but I want to give the public who's reading the ascertainment study the impression that it was a fair and balanced and broad-based approach with representation from the community at large. So broad categories. So they know, people who read it know, wow, we've included all the major stakeholder groups, residents, businesses, nonprofits, environmental organizations, without indicating names, titles, etc., just so we know there's a broad representation of the community at large that are all stakeholders in this process.
So we could list a paragraph of the areas that we're drawing from, but not how many here and all of that. Yes,
yeah.
I think we could probably do that, right? And that would work. Okay. That's collaboration right there. Okay.
If you decide to hand out titles, I know Director Puckett prefers Saint.
Well,
Director Voigt, followed by Spitzer.
I got it, Chairman. I think it's St. Nick is his preferred title.
Yeah.
Oh. Hey, Sharon, I want to thank you for your perseverance, dedication, and patience and honesty in your report. In your discussion with the 45, did the topic of our mitigation of open space to our addition to the conservatory open space in the Cleveland National Forest, that ever come up? Or the wildlife fencing along the 241?
Not any mitigations that you have given on other roads came up at all. What did come up is mitigations are very important to the people.
And so that is important to the people?
Yes, and that's listed in there as what's important for them, and they want input on mitigations. They want generous mitigations.
Okay, and my other question would be, in your discussions, did the people talk about the through traffic that goes uses the 5 as their conduit from San Diego to Los Angeles, and Los Angeles to San Diego, whether it be business or tourism, SeaWorld, San Diego Zoo, Universal Studios, everybody uses the 5 to go on either one of those from those two destinations, and so destination originated in San Diego to Los Angeles.
Yes, a lot of references were made to regional traffic using the I-5, yes.
And my last question to you, did the people acknowledge that the homes that are already destined to proceed and have had approval will impact South County mobility?
Some believe that the new homes will impact South County mobility. Some believe that is irrelevant, that you will have more cars, you will have more congestion, but that is irrelevant, that they don't want to accommodate that growth, and if we're all uncomfortable, then maybe we'll do something else. But everyone acknowledges that new development is coming online. I think there are some of those who believe that if the road capacity is constrained, it might slow that development, that somehow that development might not occur.
Well, thank you for that snapshot into what's going on in South County for mobility. Thank you.
In the hires of agreement, number one was these aren't in any particular order.
No, no order, never ordered. Page 15, is that it?
Yeah, 15 of 23.
Okay.
So there's I-5 capacity mobility problem. There's high agreement there. And then number 5 is where I want to ask my follow-up question, multiple transportation planning.
Mm-hmm.
We're now coordinating directly with OCT on the 24191 Connect. And it actually, I think, is going very, very well. Could you just talk about what is it either about this agency that people have agreement that it needs to be more collaborative and more widespread, or is it just people think it needs to be collaborative and more widespread, it has nothing to do with this agency? Can you just differentiate, do we have a credibility issue with the agency? Is that what's causing people to say go out to others? Or is it just saying it's just better to go out and work collaboratively with others? Like, drill down on that issue.
Okay, I can do that. It is both. It is not either or, it is both. There are some that believe the agency has a conflict of interest because of your mission. When you have a mission and your job is to build and manage toll roads, that's your mission. That's what you're supposed to do. They don't believe that the agency can say, that's my mission, but in this particular instance, it is not in the best interest of the South County to have the road extended. They don't believe that's possible because of your mission. So that's number one. Number two, I would tell you that the South County residents are very informed. They are very intelligent. And they know that there are different planning agencies, and they're not sure that different planning agencies are talking to one another. So they would like to see a process that is visible, open, where all those planning agencies are in the same room together, all of you talking together, so that when you come out with a recommendation, it is also coming from OCTCA, from Caltrans, from San Diego, that you are coordinating your efforts. And I guess what they're saying is, I'm willing to take another road if I know that it is going to result in benefits to everybody, and I know that you are all talking together. So it is both of those. Is that helpful?
Yeah, very helpful.
Okay. And that, I think, is an accurate description of what I heard.
Director, we have time for one more question from the director's side. All right, let's take it back to the public. Public, any other questions that came because of what was said? Yes, please.
So just a quick one. I think this would be a good starting point to go forward with a randomized telephone survey that's required to collect thousands of responses from each collective zip code. I think this is a great starting point. I think some of your concerns about, well, is this representative? Are there too many people in one sector or not? Let's use this as a starting point, again, focusing on the scientific methodology that she employed, and do it. I think then you're going to get some really significant quantity of data that perhaps would make a lot of people more comfortable. So, thanks.
And give us an accurate map of the territory.
Yes.
Part of the problems in the past is we started in a vacuum. We didn't have an accurate map of what's going on that connects all the various cities, all the various players, and really is focusing, how do we include all of this? Jeff.
Community, any other comments, questions? Okay, well, I specifically want to thank all of you, directors, community, staff, for the time today, as well as all the time in helping Ms. Browning be able to assemble this data for us. So thank you all who participated and will participate on a go-forward basis. Mr. Kramer, are there any Chief Executive Officer reports that you wish to give?
Only that Punxsutawney Phil did not see his shadow this morning, so we're going to have an early spring.
All right, directors, any reports or new business? Seeing none, I will adjourn to our next regularly scheduled meeting on February 11th at 10:30. Thank you all for participating.